Hey there, chatterheads! It's time for another tale of how TotalCon was infested yet again by the mutant-like creatures collectively known as the MythWits. The show dedicated to all things geek pop culture, drenched in absurdity and coated with sarcasm. Every week we bring you the news and reviews from the Geekoverse. We do our damnedest to be funny, but there are no guarantees. I'm your host, Peter Bryant, and joining me this week will be Mike Kafis and Jack Ballard. TotalCon is one of the best gaming conventions in the New England area, a giant small con where you have more gaming than you can shake a stick at. But at the same time, it's small enough for everyone to feel like family. It has been going strong for 30 years, bringing great gaming moments to players in the New England area and beyond. TotalCon is always held the weekend after President's Day in February. Mike and I went this past weekend and had a great time. And if you're wondering about this weird intro that I got going on, it is because the audio was all effed up during the live recording, so I am cutting this post-show. So that's it. I'm gonna now transition to the show. We're going to do the...
Indeedly-doodly.
Yeah. So it was a good time. So
we missed you, Jack. You're gonna come with us next year,
man. Yeah, I want to go. It looked like a good time.
Yeah, it's fun. Yeah. It's fun. We should try and figure it out. I mean, I know you got the end of the month insurance thing, but you know, if you get enough time, you can get away, can't you?
I mean, I can. I need some. Yeah, I need to put it in advance and stuff.
Okay,
we'll put it in for next year. It's always the weekend after President's Day.
That's not a big vacation time or anything, so that should work.
All right, fantastic. I'm going to just check the stream real quick. Mike, if you want to go ahead and start down our list a little bit. I mean, you were the driver this week, so I was thinking maybe we talk a little bit about that.
This was a first. We always take Pete's car. Pete always drives. There have been times where he's asked me to drive when he's been fatigued and tired and his sciatica was acting up. But I drove, man. I drove every freaking stinking mile. And much as I became the driver, Pete became, and I'm going to use this term very loosely, and I don't care what you say, Pete, welcome to my world. You know?
I know what you mean.
It's the guy who just points and shoots, but you're the one who's aiming, you know? And although I will say that we only got lost once and we've never gotten lost here before, but I would also like to say that where we always get lost, Philadelphia, that like my navigating anus was twitching and I was like, Pete, can you check the navigation? I'm feeling like we're about to get lost. It's only been like 6 years, right? We've been going to TotalCon. And I finally was like, I think we're about to make that mistake we always make every year. Can you check that? And you're like, oh, yeah, this is where we want to go. Mm-hmm. So good on you, Pete. Good on you for catching that.
No, you caught that. That was you. I'll give that one to you. That was all you.
If you say so. No, that was good, though. You know what? You didn't do too bad. It was just funny hearing what you were saying. And you get all pissy when I'll say, like, no, wait, you want to go straight? No, wait. And you're like, what? Go straight or not? What? Do I go straight or not? It said go straight, but now it said turn. You understand how persnickety Google is. And yes, Jack, yes, a computer told us to do something wrong. Imagine that.
No, I can't imagine that. Where in Philly did you get lost?
It's just 95 where we're supposed to go around the east side of Philly, but we always end up going around the west side of Philly. And it just takes.
Yeah. See, like 95 kind of goes up. And I'm not really sure because I never go back and look afterwards. It's always like catches me at the last moment. I think 95 actually splits. And I think it's called. I think it might even be called 95 on the map because one is sort of like a, you know, business route 95 or some shit. I don't know. Maybe it's not. I'm not going to swear to either one, but at some point 95 does this thing where if you just follow the sign 95 North, the generic 95 North, you fucking go up around the east side of Philly and it takes longer. But if you make this turn off, I think you do. I think you just get off on 295 or whatever the fuck it is. It cuts that if you're going to go north and catch 95 again, that's what you really want to take. And we always miss it because, and we figured it out. Mike and I were talking, we figured out that's right when we hit the stride of like really like talking about shit. Like we kind of like blah, 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 it's early, get some breakfast, da, 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 get on the road, talking about this, talking about that, whatever. And then we start really getting into some like deep discussion, you know, about the nature of the universe because we're going to solve everything, right? And right when you get-
You know what the problem with the world is? You know what the problem with society is, Pete? This is how we have to fix it. Oh, right. Fuck, we just- ourselves
right again. Yeah,
so that's good stuff,
but, yeah,
we didn't need too bad of time going up there, so that was good. And yes, the fact that we were turning into each other, I mean, from the very like the way that you were talking, the way I was talking, what else was it? There were shit where we were just like, oh I had to pee every 5 minutes and you didn't.
Right. Normally, no, I got this like little bladder. So Jack, I got this little bladder. Anytime you drink with me, you'll know this, right? I'm sitting there drinking some beers. Oh, I gotta go pee. Oh, you gotta go pee again. Shocker, right? It's like a, you know, like a kid's bladder. And, yeah. So we're in the car. We're driving up the road. Mike had to give in first go. And then, and I went in. I'm like, yeah, I guess I better pee because, you know, if you're going now, you're probably not going to want to go for a long time. And then I don't want to stop the trip. So I'll push some pee out. So, you know, I went in, I managed to get some out. And then we get down the road again. And next time we stop, Mike's got to pee again. I was like, what? I mean, we didn't stop to pee. We had to get gas or whatever it was. But, you know, it was just funny. It was, we were switching places like on everything. You know, he's like, wow. Do we make the turn here? And I'm like fucking eating something. And I'm like, oh, I'm sorry. I was eating my chips. What? And that's usually Mike's role. Mike's, I look over at Mike and he's like, what? We're supposed to fucking turn here. And he's like, hold on. And that was me.
Hold on. Let me pull it up. It's like, it doesn't matter. Cause if we were supposed to turn, we didn't. Oh, okay.
And you know what it is? I think some of it is the fact that when you drive, you have to pay attention and you're on point and you're like, you have to make these decisions, turn right, turn left, whatever. And when you're the navigator, you get to get lazy because you're just like, well, I'm just fucking sitting here doing nothing, you know, for like 2 hours. So, you know, 2 hours goes by and it's like, what do we do? I mean, and you're just like, huh? What? I was, what?
How long is what? About an 8 hour drive to Boston?
Nah, six,
seven. Six and a half, seven. If you get lost, Pete, that's a great segue, Jack. Why don't you tell everyone about the Massachusetts Highway Division and their ultimate wisdom and how they decided to design a particular road that we were on.
All right, so we get close, right, and we're like a half an hour from the place, and I'm getting excited because. My sciatica was acting up. My old hip was acting up, and I'm thinking, oh man, it's gonna be fucking great. We're almost there. My hip hasn't really been hurting me that much. It's really starting to hurt a little bit, but no problem. Fucking 30 minutes, we'll be there. So we're going up, and it's an navigation faux pas, right? But I'm gonna say I was handicapped by the handicap designer of this road because. We were in the left lane, and the road on the map, you know, was like, you know, go straight, and it's going to merge. This road is going to turn into another road. It's going to go around this bend, you know, kind of like just slightly around the bend, but just stay on it, and keep going north, and you're fine, right? Well, we do that, right? And then all of a sudden, we realize, oh, shit, we're in a turn ramp. Like, no, like the sign, it was like a new, like, you know, you've been like up in New York, right, Jack? You've driven up in New York?
Yeah, I'm very familiar with the trip from here to Boston.
Oh, okay. All right, cool. So it's like one of those last minute signs. Like you come up, hey, there's a turn, there's a sign. What the fuck? Oh shit, we're on the wrong road. You know?
Yeah.
And it literally did a 180. It literally went south and it went exactly. We were going north and it went fucking perfectly south.
And it was like bare right to go straight.
Yeah.
And bear or stay straight to go south. It's like,
That makes no sense. Yeah.
Yeah. It was fucking nutty. Like the road, if we, cause we didn't actually go to Boston. We were like 30 miles west of Boston. So this might not be a road that you've been on. If you go to Boston, you might not go down this way. Cause we were pretty close, but fucking, so you're on the road and it's going straight and this turnoff goes like this, right? Goes off to the right. And I'm like, but we stayed straight. And then we do a fucking 180 loop and we're going south. And I'm like, what the fuck just happened? Like, I'm like, what happened? Why are we exiting? You know? And then it, like, it not just does that, but it does it onto this like fucking turnpike. So we're like 15 minutes, like 15 miles before you can get off. It's just driving down. Oh, there goes some houses. There goes another road. There goes.
Oh, there's some people water on the highway.
It's like, I hope you didn't want to get on this because fuck you. There's no way on, you know?
Wow.
And it, so my, I'm looking at it and my destination time goes from 30 minutes to 1 hour, just like that. I was like, oh, shit.
Wow.
Right. Because 15 minutes exactly south and then 15 minutes back up the same fucking road and then 30 minutes once we got back.
God, what a nightmare.
And then his sciatica went, oh, oh God.
It's kind of like, you know, when you kind of got a shit, you start getting close to home and the shit knows that the toilet's coming and it just starts going, boop, boop,
yep.
Turtle. Put a pin in that. We'll save that till the end of the
time. The
official name for that is turtling.
Turtling, yes.
Peeking his little head out.
Yes. All right. So anyway, so that was the trip up. I mean, other than that, it was pretty cool. We've had a lot worse, fiascos driving up. That was cool.
And just in case anyone was wondering, at no point will we be telling any kind of a tiring story.
No.
Nobody got tired. Well, I was getting tired. I said, we got to stop and pull over. Like, I literally got tired. But we did not catch any tire or road debris this time around.
Right. There was no almost life-threatening products or debris flying at the car. But, so we got to the hotel. We checked in. That was fucking super easy. The con hooked us up with a room, which was cool. Thought, you know, I was a tiny bit sketchy because I had reserved a room, and then Angelia said, you know, the con is going to help you out with your room, and they looks like they covered it. So I think
sweet.
Pretty
thank you, Angelina. We appreciate it. We love you.
Thank you. But then we got the hotel. It's a new hotel. So the old location we had gone to for years and years and years, and you know, used to the layout and everything like that. And this hotel, it was a great hotel. I mean, compared to the other one, I think hotel wise, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, pretty much the same, but some cool new features. For con reasons, you know, like the rooms that we had that they gave out to the different groups was pretty badass because we had our own like gaming room.
Oh, cool!
This hotel was great. It was a great hotel. It made hotels great again. It was a really great hotel. It was great.
But the room, I would say, the room wasn't any better or worse than the room at the last hotel. You know, the rest
very comfortable for everything.
Now, there is one downside, a little bit. So when I reserved a room, I made sure I had two double beds. We got there, and it was one king bed. And I'm like,
yeah.
I'm like, this is not.
Fuzzy, fuzzy, was a bear.
I'm like, this isn't going to work.
Pete and I have discovered there is no bed big enough that can accommodate the two of us.
Now, I believe it.
Mike is a mover and a shaker. When he's
I'm a mover. I'm a cuddler. I don't care who you are. I'll cuddle your ass in bed.
Where's your hands between the two big pillows?
Pillows. I pretty much sleep like a corpse. Like I lay down and go to sleep. No, I don't really move around. Like when I get up, the bed's almost made. I can get up and just kind of push the blankets back into place. When Mike gets up, it looks like a fucking scene from Twister, right?
He's got. Like, he's think we landed in Oz.
he's pulling the fucking, you know, fitted sheet off his head. Like, how'd they get there?
True.
So, I was like, I can't do that with you. So anyway, so we talked to the woman at the front desk, and they were really cool. They gave us a pull-out couch. And Mike, I never did ask you, how was that? Was that okay? It looked like it wasn't too bad.
Brought up extra blankets and we laid them out across, and it really was a comfortable. It was the most comfortable pullout couch I've ever had.
Yeah.
So props to that.
I mean, yep. You had to put that stain company side, you know, company side down.
Yeah. And so the couch was that kind that like it had a nasty stains on one side, but if you were having company, you know, you flip it up and you were good.
Yeah. Somebody else was pulling out on that couch, apparently.
Different kind of pull out. And I don't know.
Them like monster Smurfs or something, because big
blue Smurfs.
The service from the hotel I would say was better for the most part. If you ever needed anything, they pretty much were accommodating. Except we're gonna get to the restaurant part in a second, but like, you know, I don't know what you and I were having a discussion, and the woman had come in to make.
We're talking about fucking color and shit.
What was it?
Color.
We were having a big debate. I was like, "What's your this woman? This poor woman is making the bed, right? Putting the sheets on it." When we first got there, we happened to get into this discussion about favorite color. Like, Pete, what's your favorite color? I don't know. I don't really have a favorite color. I'm like, come on, you have to have a favorite color. Everyone has at least they can. If they're a gun put to your head, you will pick a color you like beyond other colors or something. And he's like, "Nah, not me." Mm-mm. And he's like, "I don't understand. Not everyone has a favorite color." I turn around and I'm like, "Excuse me, ma'am." And she turns around. She's like,
yes.
A little bit scared. And I was like, "What's your favorite color?" She's like, "Oh, pink." And this goes back to the door. I said, "Thank you." He's like, "Fuck. Well, I don't know." And then finally, Pete, you finally were able to narrow it down. You were able to put your partisanship aside and pick a color. And what did you pick?
I picked like a bluish steel gray.
What? It's oddly specific. It's for like someone who went, he had not went from zero to like oddly specific, like super specific. Like that's
our Pete.
I don't have a favorite food, but I really well. All right, escargot. Do you know what I mean? Like
escargot prepared in the Dutch oven with
right.
With the vermicelli sauce upon it.
If I had to pick.
I don't know. Anyway, so it's funny too, because like it started, that whole conversation started because the remote control for the TV was like this shitty cyan blue. Now I may not have a color that I know I like better than others, but I have a color I know I fucking hate, and I hate cyan blue. I hate that color with a bloody fucking passion.
Right, that's what it was. I'm like, okay, so you have your least favorite color. You've definitely outlined that, like, bar none. Full stop. We know what that is. What's your favorite color? Don't have one.
But it was like stoner.
I just know it pisses me off. I don't know what's pleasant in the world. I just know it pisses me off in the world.
But it's funny. It was like stoner talk. It's like Mike. Like she walked into Mike and I after we'd eaten like a couple mushrooms or something, you know, and we're just like pontificating about the delicacies of color and. And how it affects the fabric of the universe and shit. We hadn't had anything, not even a drink, nothing. It was stupid. All right, anyway, nothing about Consuela.
Yeah. Plenty of parking.
Yeah.
The hotel, which was awesome.
We gotta make a point of that, because parking has been fucking horacious at this goddamn place. Last year there were some snow which took up some parking, but then there was fucking all this construction and they had like half the parking lot gobbled up with like construction equipment and connexes or storage containers, right? These 20-foot fucking storage containers and fencing and all this shit, right? And it's a convention, so the hotel is completely sold out and they have basically enough parking for the whole hotel and half the fucking parking lot is taken up.
Oh, shit.
And then the year before that, it snowed its ass off for like, I don't know, like a week before we, like right before we got up there. And they were like, don't worry, it'll be plowed. We'll bring in bulldozers and blah, 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 blah. And you get up there and like, Mike, what was it? Like fucking Hoth.
Yeah, it was. Right? It was. We were like digging out a spot in between, like around a curve going, you know, I think this is going to be safe enough. Like, this is just like I found the spot, and like the hotel security said, yes, you guys can park there. I said, like, I've dug this out. Is this okay?
Yeah, it was a nightmare. And this parking lot is like a football field. I mean, there was like you could have parked fucking twice as many cars as the place needs. It's like they overkilled the parking lot. So that was good.
That's what you need though. If you have a big convention, a bunch of people coming in from out of town, that's what you need.
Yeah, shit. Yep.
Enough about like parking and beds and shit. Let's talk about what's important, okay? Because I don't know if you've known this, but I'm a fan of food. And I was a little disappointed with the food at the hotel.
Mm-hmm. Can you mention the name of the hotel? It seems like can you not bring it up?
I don't know. Like
the Best Western?
Western? Yeah, yeah.
Here, Mike, go ahead and talk. I'll find it.
Okay. It was Best Western Marlboro Travel Plaza or something like that. Mm-hmm. It's like some of the people were saying the food is okay, but like in Mansfield, Massachusetts, for instance, we would pay $20 for like this big breakfast bar, and they had about the same as what this restaurant had, and it was for $5. But crap. Like it wasn't, it was just not seasoned anything. Like they were out of salt and pepper or something. I also got one time that was like just kind of with water. So
that is a good flavoring agent though. Water. You add that to everything. I mean, it's very tasty. So
yeah. But
natural flavor.
Not make a good homeopathic food.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the tuna's from water. So, I mean, you would think that just kind of all goes together.
I know.
It was.
But it doesn't.
It was the Best Western Royal Plaza Hotel. But all right, so
now when I see that,
Mike, I don't want to dig on the restaurant that bad. The food wasn't horrible, okay? It wasn't like I don't know. It was just bland. It was just bland. Like everything I got there was bland. Like
was it better than like high school cafeteria food?
Yeah,
like,
well, yeah,
that's
way
what
better.
I'm imagining. Okay.
Yeah. No. It was all right. It was edible. It was totally edible. I ate like you know. And Mike, did you say the fries are pretty good? Or no, I had the fries. No, the fries were good. That's right, I had them too.
Well, you really have to fuck up French fries. I mean, you really got to try hard to fuck up fried potatoes and salt.
So, and you know, I think what made this difficult was when we did eat, like we ate it in the green room mostly, and it's unfortunate that the con had to spend extra money for this, but their loss was our gain that the hotel wasn't allowing them to bring in outside food. Or to bring in outside food to be cooked in the hotel. So they had to bring in Boston Market. They had to bring in where was those other places they went? They brought in spaghetti.
The Olive Tree or whatever, Olive Garden.
So, like, we ate, like, really good, like, restaurant-quality food, like, in the green room, which was awesome. So thank you for that.
Yeah, that was good. I mean, the cooked food they have every year prior was good, too. I mean – you know, Angelina would cook up like barbecue chicken and shit, and it was good, you know. But it worked out really well. I mean, and I was really happy. I was worried about the green room not having any food because I'll tell you. So Jack, when like running a lot of events, running around and doing stuff, the con, I don't have a lot of time to stop in a restaurant, especially when I'm running stuff. But then I'm also networking and talking to people and stuff. So it's like, and I forget like, oh shit, I have to have time to eat, you know.
Yeah.
So I'll like and run like, an event and I'll have like an hour and a half between events and I'll run into somebody like, you know, some like an industry person or somebody I hadn't seen since last year. And I'm like, next thing you know, oh, fuck, I'm not going to be able to get to eat now. You know, it just happens.
Yeah. So that was the – and that's why they have green rooms. And that's a good thing. Now, guess we could move on.
Yes, please.
I guess we could move on from food.
to where it comes out?
So, I mean, I guess you could say that Clodor was probably the meme of our trip because we've always outlined in the past that Pete and I do develop some sort of a meme, and this was a shared meme. So, as he is wont to do, to stink up a room with his throne, he was gaming his throne. And so he was getting ready to come out, and I started yelling up against the door. I was like, Clodor, close the door, close the door, Clodor, 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 Clodor. 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 And I was like, that's your new name, Clodor.
Oh, ooh. Man, yeah. Yeah. It, I mean,
I watched Game of Thrones, but...
What's that?
If you're not a true geek, you shouldn't be watching this show.
Yeah, true. All right, so
I got some
That's it. That's enough. Enough of the hotel. The hotel was what it was. You know, I'm hoping that next year maybe the restaurant staff will be a little better off. They'll be ready for us next time.
So we were there. Why were we there? Like, we went off to TotalCon. It's a mancation, but it also is a working.
Yeah.
What did we do there, Pete? I mean, like, when we weren't eating and shitting, what were we doing?
So normally we do. We'll do like MythWits. We'll take MythWits up there and we'll do like a MythWits show, or we'll do like, you know, I do this thing called Blixapalooza where I put together like a roughly about a 4-hour show, right? Where I have all these different events and stuff I come up with. And this year, I didn't want to do that. I didn't want to carry all the equipment. I just wanted to go up and run games. And I've been doing a lot of stuff with TSR. So basically, they gave us a room to run events in, and it was like an official TSR room. So we filled that fucking room all weekend with events. I got a couple other game masters and we worked out a schedule, and we had three tables in there, and not quite every hour of gaming time was a table filled, but almost every hour. I mean, there was only a few tiny little spots that weren't covered with our gaming goodness. So I think I ran like five events. Which is a lot. I've never run that many at a con. James ran a bunch. Jay Libby ran a bunch. We had Doug in there. He ran several. Chris Pierce ran a bunch. So it was good. And the one night, the one that really stands out, was this Game of Thrones. And it's, I can't believe I'm admitting this. It's my first LARP. we ran a LARP.
It's a LARP. Pete, what's a LARP?
Fireball.
Wait a minute. I got to restart this audio engine. One second. Sorry, my thing was dicking up on me. All right, so a LARP is like an RPG. So it's got the RP in it, role playing, but it's what they call live action role playing. So it's not so much dice. It's more like people take their characters on and they get away from the table. Well, I mean, we still had tables and stuff, but they mostly get away from the table, and it's a lot of interaction, and it's a lot less game mastering and a lot more character players interacting with each other. So we had three tables, and we had five players at each table, so there was 15 people in the room, and then James had a table, I had a table, and Chris had a table, and basically we set the adventure up, we got things in motion, and then we let the players go. And they basically interacted with each other. They asked us things that they could do. We said, yeah, sure. And then I have to go tell the other game master. And then he would tell the other, you know, we'd tell each other. We the game masters kept meeting and like, okay, these guys are doing this. Okay, these guys are doing that. Okay, these guys are doing this. All right, well, if they're doing this, our guys are doing this. So we're going to have a problem there. It was pretty cool. A lot of interaction. And then when we weren't meeting each other, and, you know, you're familiar with Game of Thrones. You know how they have ravens, right? Well, we had our raven. Where is he? I'm going to put the camera on the raven.
Caw-caw! Caw-caw!
So the people would write notes, and they'd call for the raven, and Mike would come over, and they'd give him the note, and he'd go take it to whoever had to, like, answer it. And then they would write their answer and bring it back. And the difference is, like, normally when you're, like, a game master, you tell them, oh, this is what I'm going to say. All right, well, this is what you get in return. In this, it was very literal. Like the person got the note as it was written, and the person got the note back as it was written. And they said, well, what does this mean? I'm like, that's the note you got, you know?
Pete, I don't know why. Like, I was passing notes from table to table. I get over to Pete's table, and his people are like, I don't know why they thought they were so privileged. But they were like, okay, so here's what we need you to tell the other place. And I was like, I'm a raven. I'm not a talking donkey. Right there.
Well, I don't think they were aware that we were going to be that literal, because it was the first one that they did. Yeah. So
it was funny. I was glad I was able to straighten that out for them.
Yeah.
So when they were LARPing, you basically just played a bird. Is that what I'm? Is that you were a bird?
Caw-caw. Let me tell you something. By the end of it, boy, were my arms tired.
Oh.
Right. No, it was good though. I mean, I know it sounds kind of goofy and everything, but it was a lot of fun. And they had a fucking blast. And the people, like all the people that were in that thing, whenever they passed me in the hall, you know, they were just like, "Oh, it was a great game. It was so great." And you know, word got around. People were talking about it afterwards. So it was a fucking badass event. It was the only event there like that.
And you ran two other types of things. Go ahead and promote the one thing that you were doing.
Yeah, so I did Cube of Death. So the Cube of Death that's going to go out on Kickstarter in the next couple months. I don't have them with me, but I took my playtest decks up, and I ran a couple games of that, and then I ran like in the one format, and then in the bar type format. I didn't run as many of those as I wanted to because I was fucking burned out every evening. But one night I did sit down and do a bar top version of it with a couple people. A lot of people were excited, had a good time with it.
Notes, you actually were able to learn a couple things. We found out that Pete, he is a fattist, like a racist, but he's a fattist. He didn't even
realize. Yeah, I've known that for a long time. He's
It translates in his writing. Aww. And that came out.
Well, what was the example?
All right. Now, this is funny. Right, do you want to tell it, Mike? Or you want me to tell it?
I want you to tell it.
Okay. So, all right. So the version that I was running was the full-on adventure version. So I write an adventure, and then, but they're very short. They're like little descriptions, like a paragraph or two of what the character sees, and then I give them a choice. So it's almost like a choose-your-own-adventure. In that, you know, you can do this or you can do that. And then when they pick it, the easier decision, like I try to escape, and that they would get an easier type question. So you remember the ones where you got the two categories? They would get one of those. But if they were like, "Oh, I'm going to stay and fight the monster," they would either get one of double damage or a volley question. And then, of course, if they win, if they get it right, they get a treasure. And the treasure can help them, like, avoid other things, or they can get healing, or they can, you know, knock out another character or whatever. So I was running that, and I'm reading through the adventures, and there's this one part of the adventure where I'll tell you what the idea was, and then I'll tell you how it went over. Or should I tell it the other way around, Mike?
Yeah, the other way around.
Okay. All right. So, you know, I say, all right, you find a secret door, and you start heading down a passageway that looks like it goes between. It's a secret passageway that goes between two rooms, and it was designed for a much thinner person. And you get stuck, right? And it's like you have to answer the agility question to get free. Like you're going through, and you get stuck.
Now, there's one other small minor detail we need to elaborate on to make this situation illustrate this, and that is that our friend Corey, who is he's a portly gentleman, he was at the table, and he was player number three, and he was the unfortunate player who got stuck.
Right.
Always happens to that guy.
Corey's one of my best friends, right? And it's funny because he's sitting there, and I read this thing, and I look up, right? Because And when I tell you how I designed it, you might understand a little bit of my innocence in this, right? Or why I thought it was innocent, why I would assume it was innocent. I look at him, and he's looking at me, you know. He's looking at me like, he's like, "Really? Really? Fat guy got stuck in the hall." And I'm like, "Oh, shit." Right? And then everybody starts laughing. It was funny, right? And then Mike made the suggestion. He's like, "Maybe next time you say it was designed for a shorter person, right?" And then someone else goes, "Yeah, great." And then you'll get a little person at your table, and they'll be the one
to get. No, you got a midget, yeah. Right. Well, just you know, when I played Cube of Death, you also called me fat, my character, because I came crashing through the plate glass ceiling, remember?
Wow, Pete, you are like,
so I feel there was a tear. I don't know if you saw it trickling down my face, like the Indian that gets hit by trash. Like they, like it was like I feel the pain. Like I turn, you know. Huh. So I'm skinny fuck making fun of all these fat guys. You're gonna get it, man. You're gonna wake up. You're gonna get stuffed with a bunch of Twinkies and Oreos. You don't know what could happen.
So this
he's gonna wake up in a fold and not know which way is up.
That's right.
No, so this is what I need to do. I need to vet these with people because, you know, like...
With fat people. That's what you mean. You have to vet them with fat people. You gotta go to Weight Watchers clinic. Hey, you mind if I read these questions to you?
Yeah. Like, Pete, I didn't know if you knew this or not, but, like, you've alienated three quarters of any con-going, you know, population right there. You just alienated them.
And that's several tons of people.
Yeah,
I know, right? So look, All right, so let me tell you where I'm coming from on this and why I claim my innocence. When I designed this dungeon, it was based off a specific person. Like, I actually wrote a little bit of a backstory. This is this guy, Telamon the Great, and he was a wizard, right? And he was the typical scrawny little Mr. Burns type wizard, you know what I mean? So he had this secret passage for him to get through, and it was supposed to be like between two rooms so people wouldn't notice, so it was just big enough for him to get through, and he's a scrawny little guy. And when I wrote it, I was thinking of adventurers, and I was thinking like Conan, you know? I wasn't thinking of a fact. I was thinking of like a muscular guy gets stuck, he's got all this equipment, and he's a big barbarian, and I get stuck in the hall. That's what I was thinking. But you see, that's not who's playing the game.
You know? Yeah. Well, you need to put more questions that make it like a disability to be skinny. So if it's a little too cold for someone of your body weight out here. So you're taking
yes.
damage.
Okay.
Or you're a little fatigued because you're hungry and you don't have any kind of fat stores.
Right. Right.
You know, stuff like that.
I can do that. Right, right. Or you're standing on a bridge and the wind is blowing really hard, and because you're so skinny and frail, it's going to blow you off of it. And then people say, hey, that was a great game. I loved it.
No. That fit person would be weight challenged.
The what?
Weight challenged.
All right. Yes.
Okay. Anyway, so Cube of Death went over well. It was a lot of fun. I did take notes, not just on the adventure thing, but on some of the cards. There was some of them, you know, like you were saying, Jack. You know, some of them are kind of dick cards. You know, like
they're pretty obscure, dude. Like, right. Seriously,
it's like
some
like,
of those. I mean, most of them are good. They're good right. questions, but some right. of them are like you had to have just watched that movie like yesterday. Because, you know what I mean?
Well, Michael, tell you, there was one of them that it was the Rubik's Cube question, right? So yeah. The question is, you know. What was Rubik's Cube originally known as, right? No one knows the fucking answer. No one's going to know. Nobody's going to know that. However, I switched it around. What popular toy was originally known as Magic Cube? And when I asked them that question, and I didn't tell them what I was asking them. I reversed it first before I asked them. And they were like, Rubik's Cube. And I'm like, see, you can at least guess. There's at least a chance to get that one right.
Yeah.
You know,
right.
And that's the way some of these questions need to be written. They're like, no one's going to know this, but if I write it a certain way, they can at least get a reasonable guess. It's like, dude, you could have logically come up with that. Trust me. You could have like, it's a toy and it's a cube and it was very popular.
Yep.
How many really popular cubes were there?
And you know? I think Jack
Hubert.
Yeah.
Hubert.
What makes, what do you call it? Cube of Death work for the trivia portion of the game is that people have a balance of what they know, and Pete I think has done a pretty good job like putting something that at least somebody, if you're a card carrying geek, you know a small portion of the entirety of it. So the cards can fuck you if you just keep getting the wrong questions, and that can happen.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, I know, because Jack, you were playing, and you're just like, Mike, you get a question, be like, motherfuck, right?
Mike would get a question like, what comes after six? And then I would get a question like, how many shots were fired in the Battle of Endor? And I'd be like, are you kidding? You know what I mean? Like,
right. Yeah, yeah. So anyway, so we did that, and that was fun. And then I did two other things. I'm not even really going to talk about it too much. It was a Savage Worlds game. I just did that to have a game in there, and I like running Savage Worlds, and it's fun, so I ran it. It's an adventure I ran, and I wanted to play test the adventure a little bit more. And then I ran Acrid Herald, which is TSR's new game that's going to be Kickstart. It's going to release next month, and it's going to have its real name. Acrid Herald's not the real name. It's gonna happen. Mike, don't say it because I'm not supposed to even remotely give it away. Not even that thing we were playing with. Right? Right? So anyway.
What kind of a game is it? Can you say
yeah,
that?
Yeah, because we were playtesting. It's a spy game. So it's a, oh, like cool. a slightly in the future spy game. Like not future, not like, you know, spaceships or anything like that. It's just like 10 years from now. So you can have some interesting new tech.
Yeah.
And they changed the world up a little bit. So some stuff has happened in our world that makes it more spy friendly, like more opportunities to spy and stuff like that. But it's not like drastic.
I think we're pretty spy friendly as it is from what I'm seeing in the news.
Yeah.
I see what you did there.
Well, we are.
No, that sounds cool.
But they did some stuff like there's like an agency that is kind of like an Interpol, but it's a new kind of Interpol, and you know it's just some extra stuff to make it even more spy-y. But yeah, it was cool. So I ran that for James, and it was funny because I had seen the game before, but I never played it or ran it. And then the first real exposure I got to it was I played it from 10 to 12 in the morning. Then I took lunch, and then I ran it from 1 to 3. And
I think good job.
Yeah, it was all right. It's a pretty simple game.
Did good.
Yeah, so it was good. And then, the name is going to be released next month at GaryCon, and then the Kickstarter is going to launch. And then, of course, we'll be promoting that on the show. And I think everybody's going to be really fucking excited about this. I really do. I mean, I can't say why, but I think people are going to be very excited about this, and it should be cool.
Awesome. I'll check it out.
And that's about it for the events and stuff. I mean, you know, we have other happenings. Right, Mike?
Yeah. Like what?
Well, our buddy Steve went up, and Steve was doing some stuff there. Steve Wallet. He's an honorary MythWit. He was doing some stuff up there. Why don't you tell him what he was doing there, Mike?
Like, not that we're, like, haters or anything, because, really, we do all support each other. But, you know, Pete and I were a little... You know, there was at least one or two of the deadly sins when we were sitting.
Motherfucker could be a little jealous, a little bit.
Yeah, jealous, a little coveting thy neighbor's free Sony $8,000 camcorder. You know, but you know what? Steve did the work. He did the legwork with Nerd Rage News that's been around for a long time. Everyone should check it out when you get a chance. Just nerdragenews.com, correct? And, you know, it's a blog and an interview site, and he's really trying to expand it more. And he was talking about doing a documentary, and he was sitting on some forums for, filmmakers, and he was asking questions. How can I get some free equipment? How can I get people to sponsor me? And he was just getting advice from other people on the forums and, you know, on the blog. And they were telling him, well, you should go to blogs like this and write companies and, next thing you know, Mr. Gold falls out of the sky on my lap. Steve Wallet gets a letter from the president of Sony saying, we're going to give you a free Sony camcorder, like a, you know, prosumer version of, you know, $8,000 camera and some lighting and some tripods. And, you need some hookers too? We'll send you a geisha girl too. What the hell? And
wow.
He gets all this stuff. But it's legit. He's not like – he wasn't trying to cheat anyone out of it, and he does have a project. And one of the project is like a documentary on basically gaming, correct?
Yeah. It's a documentary on gaming and gamers. Not anything in particular. Not like – you know, like a lot of people are doing like D&D, and there are people doing like the history of gaming. He's just doing one on just modern day gamers and gamer society.
Yeah, gamer society. Thank you. And he's interviewing gamers, interviewing
– game designers and –
yes, and from children to adults, it's just sort of a I think like a shallow dive across the board, which I think is
cool.
Yeah,
yeah.
He actually has a I don't know, what would you call? Is it Brocky?
Yeah, Brocky was her real name. Well, Brocky is her real model name.
Okay,
like her professional, like working name, like
right. But she's like an assistant. She's a helps she's like organize.
She was help organizing stuff. But she was doing all the interviews. So she was the face on camera, and Steve was the engineer.
So and they interviewed a lot of people. And I you know we were big supporters of that, and we can't wait to see it.
Yeah.
I think you've got a great idea, too. I mean, you know, say what you will about Steve, Pete. I mean, I don't know why you always talk bad about him, first of all. But, you know.
Not always.
He's got a great idea. He's going to take this footage, and he's going to take it down to MICA, which is the Maryland Art Institute. And he's going to say, I would like to, you know, for your film majors to take this, if anyone wants the challenge or wants to go for an internship, and give them a challenge to see, you know, which ones can come up with the best, you know, or I don't know whether it's like footage and they can put a sample together and then he can pick and then they can do an internship and then that's how he's going to get his film made.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
And he's well, I think he's going to, I think there's a prize involved and I honestly think he's going to have them edit it and he's going to pick the best one, but I'm not sure. I mean, that's a hell of a thing to edit a whole film and then like get, I don't know exactly what he didn't really go into. I don't think he really knows exactly how he's going to do it yet. But anyway, yeah. So he had this this woman who was local to the area, Asian girl. It's a Brocky. That's kind of an odd name. Like I don't know what that is. Is that, you know what I mean? Like when I first heard it.
Max, you tell me. I mean, you know, people have weird names sometimes, right?
Yeah, I know. It was. What's that? What'd you say?
You say Blix? You tell me, Blix. Yeah.
Yeah, I know, right? But I was just like, it was weird because I every time I heard it, I was kind of like, yo, hey, Adrian, Brocky here, gonna take me. But
I found it hard to call her Brocky, too. So moving on.
No, she was cool. No, I do want to say this. She was really cool. Like, we got to know her, and she was really cool. She, you know, she's funny, and she's a go-getter. I mean, she's talking about, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. And I don't want to go into what they were talking about because I don't think that they want that public yet, but they've got some big ideas.
And the MythWits may very well be involved. So that's all I want to say.
We may be looking forward to
maybe that growing.
Now moving on to another funny person we had up there. So our buddy Corey, like I said, he played in the game. He was there and he was his normal self. And there's really not a whole lot to tell. I mean, Corey's Corey, you know, but he brought his son.
Evidently, Corey's son, Corey Jr., is Corey too.
No, his son is so much like him. I mean, it's so fucking much like him. And, like, the way Corey talks, his mannerisms, like, some of the shit that he says is just like, God, that's so Corey, right? And so Corey's a low talker, right? When he talks, he's like, hey, man. And you're like, fuck,
well, what, Corey? I was thinking, you know, this is good to meet. Because I was, you know, asking him, what do you think? Get out, we'll see.
Right. So Corey Jr. is the same way, right? But he's tall. I mean, he's taller than Corey. What is he, like 6'5", something? I don't know. He's a tall kid, right?
I swear to you, if he looks like he's 23, he looks like he's 25. And the child is 15.
Yeah.
Oh.
A big old fucking man child, right?
He is. He's a man child. He's fucking Lenny.
Right. So, but he's, like I said, he's quiet, right? He's quiet just like Corey. And motherfucker sneaks up on you. So I'm standing there talking to Mike, right? And he's like tall, right? So he comes up behind me, like, and he's like this much taller than me, right? Because I'm not a very tall guy to begin with. So he comes up behind me and he's standing there and he's like fucking like right up on me, like he's about to like take advantage of me almost, that close, you know? And I'm like standing there, like, ah, Jesus Christ, you're fucking sneaking up on me, man. Right.
Yeah, he does that. He did that often.
Right. Every single time, like, God damn it, where'd you come from?
And the thought of what a prank, a practical joke from a 15-year-old standpoint, and when you're like in your 40s, what a practical joke is, it's vastly different, especially at a con. So this child, this man-child, sees eclairs, a container of eclairs that have been in this gaming room for 3 days. 3 days. These eclairs, this package of eclairs, have been sitting on a table. He thinks, you know what would be funny? I'm going to get these, and I'm going to give them to Steve.
Right.
And I said, no, you're not. No, you're not. You don't understand. You don't understand what gamers do.
gamers just do nothing but touch their nuts, and then they touch these game pieces, and they touch food, okay? So these eclairs are just wrought with ball and figure and everything else. It's just, no, you're not going to do that to Steve. Not my friend, because we're 40. We have, like, a healthy fear of death from concrete.
So yeah. So he's like, got a bag of eclairs.
What the fuck, dude? Oh, you're gonna kill him!
Wait a minute. But what else did he? He gave you something else too. What was the second thing?
Are you really gonna throw the poor boy under the bus on this one?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. He has a what is that called? He has like a camaraderie with Steve. And so, but he was asking Steve to take a couple things home with him. You know, I bought these games, so I don't have to fly them home. Can you take them home and give them to my dad? Yeah, okay, I can do that. And then he hands Steve a big bag, like a big, you know, like a big shopping bag or whatever. Here, can you take this? And Steve's like, all right, well, what's in this? Hamburgers. What? Hamburgers. I'm not taking these hamburgers home. I'm not going to see your dad for like 2 weeks. So just give them to somebody, I guess.
Were they really hamburgers?
Yes!
Just give somebody a pack of hamburgers. Hey, you look like you're hungry. You like a hamburger?
Wow.
Yes. Corey, he's 15. I mean, you know.
He's so funny.
It's fucking awesome.
I was going to cut it in his mouth.
So he played a lot of games and stuff, was hanging around. He had a good time. He was fucking excited. He loved it. He's like, I'm coming up next year. I want to come up next year. So,
I know we're running out of time, but I wanted to make two. I want to definitely make sure we get talking about Wargaming Recon, us helping them out, and also get it. Let's just talk about the cocktail party. So, real quick, I was volunteered, which is fine. I was more than happy to do it to help. Voluntold. Oh, thank you. To help Jonathan Reinhardt and Wargaming Recon. And it has been he's been doing that podcast for a good 2 years, 2.5 years.
No. He's been doing the podcast for like 10 years. It's the oldest wargaming podcast that he can find online. The oldest long running podcast. It's like he's in the chat room. He'll tell me. Go ahead.
Because I'm pretty sure, like, he said
10 years.
He's been doing it for 10 years?
He just verified it, 10 years. Yeah, I did a 10-year logo for him.
Okay, all right. Okay, I believe.
And he says, in capital letters, longest-running tabletop wargaming podcast on the planet. All right, go ahead.
All right. And it was an honor, and I enjoyed myself thoroughly to help out and just kind of run the audio for them, make sure that everything was good between him and Adrian. I cannot wait for him to post that. It had been a while since I'd listened to any of the Wargaming Recons. Because, Jonathan, you know too, when you're a podcaster, you rarely get to listen to anything else. You know, you're so burned out from all the work you do on your own. It's like, I don't know. But I cannot wait to hear how well it went, how it sounds again, hearing it, you know, without you guys being there. But you and Adrian, and I told them, you know, face-to-face, or I told them to their face, that they need to find ways to always be at the microphone together, because they really do play off each other. Not like you and I, Pete. Not like two ferrets trying to argue over, you know, who's going to get the microphone. Like Adrian, the best thing about him is he says so much by saying so little. Like what he says volumes. You and I just can't do that. We need to be verbose and, you know, loud. That being said, it was fun hanging out with them. And then just after we recorded, and then you came back and yelled at me for not getting the alcohol and made me leave after I had been bad mouthing you. God knows what you guys talked about when I left.
Nothing.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Other than that, cocktail party, which I think was a roaring success. I would say that there was more than enough alcohol to make up for last year and this year.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Last year we had the cocktail party in our room, and And, you know, I didn't really buy much alcohol because I figured, you know, most people bring their own alcohol with them and stuff. And but you know, it turned out that Jay did bring some shitty alcohol, and it was enough to keep people kind of happy. But last year there wasn't enough, and people were kind of like, it's kind of dry, and they laughed. And so ever since then, for the last fucking year, James has been up my ass about having alcohol at this party. So he's like, oh, we got another, this party isn't going to be dry. It's going to be dry. Like every fucking time we talk about it, I'm like, James, I guarantee you there's going to be alcohol at this fucking party. So we did. We did it up. We had beer. We had wine. We had fucking cider. We had rum and vodka and fucking all everything. We had all kinds of shit.
Okay, we brought the bar. So I told Mary and James this. I said, when you weren't around, I said, I know you guys don't think of Pete as being sensitive, but he is scarable, and you have scarred him. Like, he is never going to be able to let this go. And James goes, good, he shouldn't.
Damn. All right, anyway, so we did the cocktail party, and you know, the alcohol was fine. Everything was fine. It was a great setup. We don't generally tell tales out of school when it comes to the cocktail party. That's for us. So we don't really talk about what goes on there. It's nothing crazy. It's not like, ooh, these swinging gamers, you know, they were, you know, whatever.
There's no people by the door.
Right. But you know, we kind of keep that party to ourselves. It's sort of our thing. But I will say,
party always has a tense moment. That's all I'm going to say.
Right. And this party there's no votes. Difference.
Someone might have gotten scalded, and that person is not anywhere on these screens. And that's good. And that's good.
Not this year.
That's all I'm just saying. Other than that, we had fun. I guess, Pete, do you have the picture, or do we want to reveal? I don't know if we reveal this from the cocktail party, what the secret bizarre animal is.
That's for us. We're not going to reveal that.
All right.
That's part of the party. All right, so why don't we do – we got two things to do with this party left. Let's give shout-outs to who was there, people we missed, and then I want to show something that we captured after the party.
Okie dokie.
All right, so you want me to do it?
You say who was there, and I'll say who wasn't there because it's shorter.
So we had Frank Mincer. We all know Frank. Yeah, good old Frank was there, of course. Tim Kask was there. Our buddy Don Higgins, the Pondsmiths, all three, Mike Cody and Lisa Pondsmith, they're the cyberpunk crew. Steve Percorni, who was known for his Dwarven Forge. John Wick, the master of the 7C, game designer.
First of all, every person that you've mentioned so far, I would just like to point this out. If you are watching this podcast for the first time, every person has been on an iteration of the MythWits. Yeah, there is an interview. If you wanted to ever hear anything about Frank Mincer, Tim Kask, Don Higgins, actually Don hasn't, but he's scheduled to be on when his book's done. The Pondsmiths, Steven, John Wick, they've all been on our podcast. They've been on the whole been here before.
Right.
Just wanted to point that out. Go.
Okay. So Steve, and especially Steven and John Wick are both like super, super successful lately. They're both $1 million Kickstarter people. So they've got some really good shit, really good products. All right, so then let's get into the more mundane crew. we had our buddy Corey Scott was there. Dave Brewer, who's Dave Brewer? Which one was that? Which guy was that? Was that the he ran a booth, right, in a vendor?
I think so. Yeah. Okay. I think he was one of the guys who ran. Yeah.
Okay. Yep. Jeff Tulane, our buddy Jeff Tulanian, who does Hyperborea, Swords and Swords of Sorcery, has the longest fucking name for a game I've ever seen. Astonishing Swords and Sorcery of Hyperborea. Fuck, it's a great game. It's really cool. James Ward was there. He's an artist. Steve Parento stopped in. He's one of the guys that runs the con. Him and Angie both there. They run the con. They came in and hung out at our party. Of course, the ever wonderful Renee Libby, Jay's wife, his much, much, much better half. Mary Lindholm, that's James's wife. And she's a, I mean, I don't want to make, no, she's not James's wife. She is a friend of ours. She works with TSR. She is her own person, but she is married to James.
She happens to be married to James.
So, of course, Steve Wallet was there. Brennan Hill, he's another guy who does a lot of vending, and he gave a fucking awesome speech at the party about, you know, the beauty of the hobby and the friends coming together and all that. Jonathan Reinhardt, we've mentioned him before. Yeah, he was there.
I know him.
A new friend of ours, Dan Roy, he does a lot of stuff with like map design and gaming and stuff. Adrian Benson, I don't know who that is.
Adrian is who works with Jonathan on their podcast.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. All right. Yeah, I wasn't sitting in the room right. I missed his name. Okay. Sorry. Sorry about that, Adrian. Jen Gerber and Ben Gerber, the Gerbers, they were there.
The baby Gerber?
The baby Gerber. And of course, and I said James Carbio. All right. So who wasn't there? Who did we miss? What if Jay Libby on this list? How'd you miss Jay Libby? Jay Libby, of course, was there. It was in his fucking room. So, yeah, he was there.
Renee Libby, that's all you needed to say. Oh, God. Michael Curtis was not there, and we missed him terribly. And Mark Edwards, who has been on the show as well. And Dr. Nick, who has been on the show as well. I feel like there were some other people that we missed, but these are the only ones that I could remember.
Yeah, it's, you know, there's so many people come and or whatever and don't come or whatever. But anyway, so we want to say thanks to Steve, Angela, Jen, and all the staff. Thank you. Great, great fucking con. So anyway, that was that. That's it. That's TotalCon.
Awesome.
And we had a good time. And Jack, you have to come with us next time. It's a good time.
Yeah, definitely.
So, Mike, do we have time? Do we want to do the game? Do we have time?
I'm more than happy to. We can try and run it real quick. You want to just run this game real quick, and we'll here. I want to do this. Hey, everybody! We're going to play a really quick game. We're going to be playing a movie soundbite type of game, where I am going to be reading you the name of. Are you playing it too?
No.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Hey, everybody. We're going to play a game. I am going to read you a sound quote, and you are going to tell me, is this quote from the movie Star – is it from the Star Wars or is it from the Star Trek? So it's a memorable – it's a quote that should be memorable. Okay, it's not going to be like, shoot him down. Okay, whatever. So, and as a meta game inside the game, we'll just alternate between you two. And when I ask you this question and you guess, I will reveal the answer through a sound bite. So okay. You will have to tell me for this particular soundbite, specifically, is it from which part of it is it from? Which, like, for instance, I might give you maybe a lightsaber, and you'd be like, "Oh, that's a lightsaber." You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
All right, here we go. We're gonna start with Jack. Jack.
Yes.
Number one. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
The quote is. Why in God's name would you want that bucket of bolts? Star Wars or Star Trek?
I would think that they were referring to the Millennium Falcon. And really, that's the only ship I can think of in science fiction that's so often verbally degraded. So I will go with Star Wars.
Yeah, we're going to go with Star Wars. And the answer... is okay. Hold on. This is harder than you think when you're looking at Star, Star Wars, Star Trek. The answer is Star Trek, believe it or not. And Star Trek is this. So you didn't get your point, but can you tell me what that sound was from? Star Trek.
That's the transporters from the Next Generation.
All right. You get half a point.
So you get a full point for guessing.
I have a quick question. Are these from the movies only, or are these from the TV show, or
from anything?
Anything. So we have this huge Star Trek universe of TV and shows, and we have seven Star Wars. Okay, gotcha.
Right.
I'm on.
Shut up. And that was when they were looking. They were getting onto the Star. What do you call it? They were going to take the, I believe, the Enterprise again. And he said, why in God's name would you want that bucket of bolts?
All right, so hold on. So it's 0 points for the movie and half a point for the sound right. effect.
Yes.
0.5.
All right. Okay, my turn.
And here's yours, Pete. In my experience, there's no such thing as luck.
Can I steal?
I'm going to say that's the Star Trek.
And the show or movie that that was set in was... Which was?
TIE Fighter. That's Star War? That's the Star War.
Yes,
TIE Fighter.
In my experience, there's no such thing as luck.
Oh, yeah. That's Mr. Kenobi. Gotcha.
All right.
So I didn't know if that was, I didn't know if that was a Spock thing or, yeah.
Back to you, Jack.
Yeah.
We used to come here for school retreat.
That's got to be Star Trek. There's no mention of school in Star Wars.
Nice.
And it is...
Really?
Yes. Star Wars. Now, I got these from a legit online quiz, so I'm not, you know, I'm going with the answer. It would have been torn apart by now. So I don't have all of the answers. It doesn't give all the breakdowns.
Well, did it say when that line was uttered?
No, it did. This one didn't, no.
Then I don't believe you. Fake news.
Okay. That's what makes America great now.
The sound effect, do I get a half a point for that?
Yes, if you can tell me what it was.
It's R2-D2.
R2-D2, correctamundi.
Okay.
All right, what are we on, number four?
Yes.
All right, number four is... Patience, my blue friend. Could be any of them, right?
I say that to my balls all the time.
It's got to be Star Trek. He's got to be talking to like an Andorian or something.
Yeah, I said the same thing. And yet, that was from... The Star War.
Yeah, who was he talking to?
I think when they were in the cantina. Patience, my blue friend.
Oh, could be. All right. That was a lightsaber.
Yep, that was. Wow, you guys are killing it on the half points, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to fucking needle this thing down. All right, go ahead, Jack.
First one to 100 wins.
All right. Jack, number five. I don't know if you've got the whole picture. But he's not exactly working on all thrusters.
I'm going to take the gambler's fallacy of logic and say that since the last one was just Star Wars, this has to be Star Trek.
Okay, that was a good shot. And it is...
Yeah.
Yeah, Star Trek. And... Can you tell me what that was?
Of course. In the original series, that's All Hands on Deck. It's also modeled after the ship, that pitch whistle that they use on the ships.
The Bozeman whistle.
Is that what it's called?
Yep. Oh. I only say that because that's the name of the file. Right. Don't act like I'm all big. Don't check out the big brain on Michael on that one.
So hold on. By my math, that's 1.5 points.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Woo! What do we call that? The Bozeman whistle.
Bozeman, hoy.
Yeah.
Joe Flacco uses it.
Go blow your Bozeman.
in the zinc.
All right, Peter.
Yes.
I like to believe there are always possibilities.
Jesus Christ. I'm gonna say Star Trek. I'm gonna say the Star Trek. The Star Trek.
Star Trek. Wow.
That there is a phaser on continuous fire.
Well, I can do continuous fire. It's like an 8-second file if you'd like to hear for 8 seconds. I shortened it for you.
These sound effects are deafening.
Are they way too loud for real?
That TIE fighter felt like it was flying through my skull. So I'm enduring it for the show.
David said that he just read that quote as if it was in a porn.
I like to believe that there are always possibilities. All right. And so now we're back to Jack. Or no, are we?
Jack. Yep.
Back to Jack is another porn thing.
Jumping Jack. Back to there's Jack. There's always a bigger fish.
There's always a bigger fish. That was said by Obi-Wan Kenobi deep within the waters of Naboo in that stupid little submarine that they borrowed from the Gungans.
Right.
Very good. Star Wars. And,
Oh, that's Wicket the Ewok.
Wow. I mean, if you really knew the fucking name for real.
That's the name, Wicket the Ewok.
Yeah.
That's his name.
Wait for that shit.
Yeah, goddamn right. You know what? Wicket, he was popular. He had his own little TV movie, remember?
No, I do not.
You don't remember the Star Wars TV movie about the Ewoks? It was on NBC. I had it taped when I was a kid. The crash land.
Dude, no? I tried to sit through that fucking thing. It is unwatchable now.
Oh, you have to be 12. I don't know if you have to be 12.
Yeah, I was 12. I hated everything about the Ewoks from day one when I saw the movie. Part of the movie. I'm going to be honest with you. I would rather have what's his name? Jar Jar Binks. What do you call it? Like forced into the third movie. Okay. In replace of the Ewoks. That's how bad I.
Are you trying to say that a teddy bear picnic taking down the Empire upsets you in some way? You have some kind of disconnect there?
It had nothing to do with the realism. It was literally just Ewoks themselves. They were just freaky, stupid, and
hey, Mike, don't forget. Yeah. Mike has a thing against furries too. So we'll just leave it there. Mike, next question.
See, next you question, got Mike. Bit by Teddy Ruxpin or something when you were a kid, so that's why you're all
Can I show you on my body where Teddy Ruxpin
touched you? Show us on the doll where the doll touched you.
He was trying to blow Teddy Ruxpin and got shocked, and he's been turned off ever since.
All right, Pete.
Yes.
Peter.
Yes.
Number 8. There's only 10 of these things, so here we go. Number 8. I didn't know there was this much green in the whole galaxy.
This much green?
Yeah, this much green in the whole galaxy.
That's hold on. That's Cheech and Chong on Planet Doobie.
There was much green in the old galaxy.
He said, hey man, it's 420 in the galaxy somewhere.
Are there any drugs in the vehicle? Not anymore.
Right. This much green in the whole fucking green galaxy green. Fuck. Shit, I don't know. The Star Trek.
Okay, Ed.
Una puta solo.
Shit.
Where did they see? Okay. First of all, if I said it like this, you would have gotten it. I didn't know there was this much green in the whole galaxy.
Right. Okay. Well, I don't know. Anyway, that was the Rodian. Who never did get a shot off because Han shot him in the fucking chest before he shot.
That's correct. All right.
Greedo was set up by his cousin. His cousin knew he was a fucking idiot, and he sent him to to go after Han so he would get killed. Just saying. Go ahead.
You want to? Are you bucking for a half a point extra? Is that what you're trying right now?
Nope.
He didn't name. What's the name of the Rodian?
Which Rodian?
The one that gets got by Solo.
Oh, that was Greedo.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. Yeah, I got it.
Oh, I knew he knew that. Okay. Number 9. Here we go, Jack.
Yes.
Remember where we parked.
that is in Star Trek: The Voyage Home, where they have the Klingon vessel parked in San Francisco with the cloaking device on, and they are walking away from it right before they get on the bus and they Vulcan Nick Pench the punk rock guy. So
says, Star Trek and double damn on you.
A double damn on you.
Anything else you'd like to add about you? You want to start like lines from the movie are also like what we said before?
Computer. Red alert.
There we go. Give him his fucking point and a half. You get is a point and a half. God.
Got it.
All right. And Pete, the last and final quote is this. From Star Wars or from Star Trek? I only work in outer space.
Bum, bum, bum. That's a tough one.
Yeah. It's a space hooker. Let me think. I only work in outer space. I only work in outer space. Fuck. Dude. Damn it. The Star War,
huh? Okay, and the answer is
shit. That is the tricorder. Tricorder.
I don't think that's the tricorder.
No.
What do you think it is?
What do I think it is?
Yes.
It's
here. I'm gonna play a longer version of it.
Yeah. It's the sound that always makes Uhura press against that earpiece and go, I'm getting something weird.
Believe it or not, that's not. And this was a hard one. I put this one in.
Let me guess. I can't get the point now because I already guessed. But it's like planet side, right? It's like a planet side sound effect. It's like, no?
You're close. It's the shuttle. It's the noise of the shuttle.
Really?
Okay.
Yeah. That's what the file said.
Oh. Jonathan says nuclear vessel.
All right.
Well,
because I had extra sounds.
Let me total this up because we do have a winner.
All right.
That. Because you had to do fucking half points, douche.
It's great having a scorekeeper monkey.
All right. Are you ready with your winner sound?
Almost.
I'll tell you who came in second place while you're getting that together. The person who came in second place was this guy right here. He doesn't know his Star Wars from his Star Trek. Did you know that the ship wasn't called the Star Trek? It was actually called the Enterprise.
Wow.
But you didn't know that. Everybody thinks it's a Star Trek, but that ship is not called the Star Trek.
Half a point. But even if you had another half a point, who would be the winner, Pete?
This guy right here, Jack Ballard, with 5.5 points to my 3.
That's right, for God and country, queen and country, or something. Queen and country, isn't that how it says?
All
for
of them.
Queen and country.
Oh, geez.
What?
Okay.
For the queen's country.
Remember that line we said we weren't supposed to cross?
I said country. What'd you say? You
crossed it. All right, so there's a couple more noises. It's self-explanatory, but I already went through the trouble of putting them in, so you're going to listen to them. Here we go.
Good God.
Warning. Warning, it may be loud.
Don't make me destroy you.
Oh, that's C-3PO.
That's right.
Because he's holding a thermal detonator.
That's what everybody did, yeah.
Yeah. Let's see what we got over here. Oh no, we know that we
oh
already.
Oh my god! Jack's fucking. Hey, Jack, oh, let me get the blood off my earphones. Hold on.
And... yeah, we did that one and this one. Oh, we did that one. Yeah. Damn it! There's
one. Are you proud of yourself?
No, oh, that one.
That's a communicator, right?
Nope.
That's a trance techno song that all the kids are doing E and listening to.
Yes, no. Fucking, anytime Spock looked into his thing to look and see what the hell he
was. The little scanny thing.
Oh, yeah. Yep. I always thought he was taking an disturbance. It looks like he's taking one of those vision tests at the DMV.
Right, I know. Hey, man, Mike, play that again. Play that again.
Captain, yeah.
I think I see something big and bulbous on Uranus.
I'm seeing a disturbance in the force. How about that one?
That's a door opening. Yeah.
All right. Are you done? Okay. All right.
You thoroughly satisfied me. Thank you for entertaining my last minute noises.
Okay. All right. Since you did all that hard work, Pumpkin. All right. I'm gonna run the closer. Everybody, thanks for coming out and watching. We had a bunch of chat between. We had a couple people in here, which was cool. People, we had somebody I hadn't seen before. He said he's very interested in the Cube of Death. He was sitting nearby and was scoping it, and he said, "I'm definitely down." I'm like, "All right, sweet, yes." Jonathan and David have been chatting it up in the chat room, which is cool. All right. So anyway, thanks guys for joining us, and here we go.